पूर्ण मद है पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। सो वेलकम टू आवर सैटरडे मॉर्निंग सेशन। वी विल कंटिन्यू ऑन आवर प्रीवियस टॉपिक दैट इज हार्मोनियस रिलेशनशिप्स। नाउ वी नो दैट लाइफ इज रिलेशनशिप। फ्रॉम द वेरी मोमेंट we become part of our mother's womb, the relationship starts. And the very moment we are born in this world, the first relationship is with mother, then with father, then with, you know, brothers, sisters in the family, uncles, aunts, and then neighborhood, and then it continues to office, continues to village, town, society at large, nation. So the relationship is inevitable part of human life. We also call that human being is a social animal, and therefore we have to be social. We have to have relationships with variety of people. And as we discussed before, these relationships are the one which actually impact our peace in the most profound way. A harmonious relationship is good for our peace. It helps us in keeping our tranquility, keeping our, you know, what you call a very, very positive thinking. Sometimes we end up with relationships which are very bitter, which are very not very conducive to our thinking. And then we end up with a lot of stress, lot of disturbance, and lot of, you know, unnecessary negative thinking in our life. So management of relationships is extremely important. Now we will continue on our this topic where we ended last. The first is the communication, that is verbal communication. Second is non-verbal communication. The verbal communication is the most important means available to us to nurture a relationship or to start a relationship. This is the most visible part when talk to each other, we discuss about things and we understand each other. So that becomes what you call one of the important foundations of relationship. Then secondly is non-verbal things which you express in the form of your gestures or, you know, sometimes your facial expressions. That becomes very important as well. Sometimes non-verbal communication becomes even more important than verbal communication. For example, you decide not to receive a call from somebody. Now that is a non-verbal communication which sends even a stronger signal than the verbal communication of receiving the call. So the non-verbal communication is extremely important. It's very, very significant in managing relationships. And so are our actions and inactions. What we do in our life, हमने क्या करते हैं, क्या नहीं करते हैं, क्यों करते हैं, ये that doing and not doing or abstaining from doing, these are again very, very important points in our relationships. So today we will talk a little bit about all these facets, how they impact our harmony in relations. The first part is, you know, the sound vibrations. As we know that in the beginning of this universe, the word Om was uttered to create vibrations. In fact, according to ancient Indian writings, the sound vibration is the one which actually started what we call Shakti in this universe. Shiva and Shakti, when Shiva becomes Shakti, it starts with sound vibration. And that is why we call it Shabd Brahma. That Brahma which expanded itself in the form of this universe by using Shabd as the force. So in our writings, actually sound vibrations have most important foundation of this universe. The modern science calls it energy. They call it that energy is the basis of universe and its functioning. But actually, in our writings, we go to the word sound, and that is why Akash, which is, you know, non-tangible, which is practically insensible, because we cannot define Akash, you know, without taking two objects into the mind. For example, we can say all that exists between sun and moon is Akash, and between earth and moon is Akash, but you cannot define Akash on its own. And Akash is actually representing sound. It's related to our sense of hearing directly. So sound has a very profound impact on our relations, on our activities on day-to-day basis, on our energy levels. So when we talk to each other, we express our sounds. When you talk to somebody with affection and love, he automatically feels happy about it. And when you use abusive language, it offends him. Now, there's nothing great in the abusive language, but why it offends? It offends because the other side, the perception is totally different. The sound waves are creating negative energy on the receiving side. And that is why, as soon as you use offensive language, the negative energy is created, which leads to conflict. When you use sound which is very positive, which is loving, which is, you know, affectionate towards others, in that situation, the relationship between the two is nurtured in a positive way. So the first thing which is important for us to maintain harmonious relationship is to use our words very carefully. To use this energy of sound, energy of vibrations in such a way that it generates more positive energy. That is the first important and significant principle to have harmonious relations. It's very easy to offend people just to use a few words which are, you know, somewhat offensive or abusive. You can destroy a relationship which has been nurtured for years. So it is extremely important to use the words which are loving, which are caring, which are affectionate, and which generates positive energy between the two individuals. This relationship could be between within the family, with the neighbors, with the society at large, or with some, you know, anonymous person on the street. This is extremely important. I have seen people who use their words carefully, who, you know, choose the words which generate positive energy, even with a very firmly negative thinking, a very firmly negative, you know, approach to a particular subject. They do not offend people. You may say no firmly, but say in a word, in the words which are not offensive. Convey in the words which are loving, which are affectionate, which are positive. That is why words are very important, and we all know that words, once they leave our mouth, they are like weapons which have been discharged. You cannot withdraw them. And they leave an impact which is far more deeper and long lasting compared to the impact of a weapon. A weapon might kill a person and finish with it, but the words which are uttered, which are offensive, which are abusive, can keep killing the people for whole life. They keep reminding him of those words, and he will continue to nurture those negative thoughts against that person. So this sound energy, these sound vibrations, these are extremely important factor in nurturing a positive and harmonious relationship. Second part, Vibrations are important, but intentions are also very important. You know, we may not directly display our intentions. And we know that a lot of people who observe, who are very meticulous in their manners, who are very protocol oriented, they do not offend people, but then their intentions are somewhere, sometimes shown in their words and in their behavior. So the intentions are also, in fact, they are more important, not also, but more important than even the words. We should not have any intention to hurt anybody. The very thought of hurting people, the very thought of jealousy against others, the very thought of hatred actually is reflected in action and words somehow, somewhere. It may not come out in short run, but slowly, slowly it comes out and it is read by the receivers properly. So intentions are very important. We don't have to decide on the intentions. We do our things with good faith, with the thought of helping others. That whatever I can do to help others, it's fine. If I can't do, let's not do it at all. So that should be the second most important factor in deciding harmonious relationship. Our intentions should not be guided either by revenge or by hatred or by ego. They should be guided by good faith. They should be guided by, you know, welfare of others, well-being of others, and they should be in the sense there should not be dishonesty in our words and our intentions. If there's a dishonesty within us, between our words and our intentions, somewhere it will be reflected. So the second important factor in relationship is, let us avoid these negative manifestations. Let us avoid hatred. Why should we hate anybody? Everybody is a divine soul. Maybe, you know, he is having different tendencies in his behavior, but we don't have to judge people. We just consider everybody as divine and work in good faith. So this is the second very, very important factor, that our intentions should be positive. They should carry positive vibrations. And if intentions are good, naturally the words which will come out of our speech will also be generally very beautiful. So that is, these are the two important factors. The third factor is that every human being is different. There's a different state of evolution of a person, and there are different experiences which people go through. So obviously you cannot expect identical reaction of your action from those people. When you get into a situation where you are, for example, leading a team, now as a student of management, we all know in a team there would be people who are very positive, very helpful. They could be people who are indifferent. They could be people who are, you know, practically neutral. They could be people who are troublemakers. But we have to carry everybody together. We cannot reform this world. We cannot choose people according to our choice, because we cannot transform the world. That is beyond us. We have to accept what is given. If somebody is living in your neighborhood, you have to deal with him as he or she is. Somebody is born as your son, you have to deal with him as he or she, he is, or your daughter as she is. Similarly, in your family, your brothers, your sisters, your uncles, aunts, you know, you have to deal with them as they are. So the acceptance of diversity, that though people are different, but they are diverse. They are different because they have different combination of the three attributes of nature, which we discussed in detail, the satraj and tam, they are guiding our attitude and our behavior, those three attributes of nature. And therefore, their permutation combinations will determine my behavior and my attributes. Now, I cannot control everybody's attributes. Those are given facts. We have to accept them. So we should accept the diversity of this world. We should accept the individual differences. We should accept that though everybody is divine, the differences arise because of the three attributes of nature, which are embedded in our, in our body-mind complex. And therefore, we should not try to transform them. The more you tell people to improve, the worse it becomes. I have experienced in my own life, the more advice you give to the people, the more negative they become towards you. So I think the best thing is not to give advice to people, but to change yourself, to accept them as given, and then deal with them in that way. So I think this is the third very important point we have to take into account in our relationships, that we cannot change people, we cannot transform this world. The relationships will have to be based on the given nature of an individual. Based on that, we change ourselves, we transform our behavior, we transform our words, and things will go ahead very well without any problem. So that is the third fundamental factor we have to take into account. Now, fourth factor is whatever you do in life, you will have people who are either criticizing you or are praising you. Praise and criticism cannot be avoided. It is impossible. This is the very nature of this world, because we are all different. We all perceive this given situation in a different way, and we react to that situation according to our own attributes. Therefore, whatever you do, there were a lot of criticism against Lord Krishna. There were a lot of criticism against Jesus Christ. He was actually hanged. There were a lot of criticism of Buddha, a lot of criticism of Mahavir Jain. Even today, there are people who make fun of those great guys, great people, great souls. So don't think that the great souls will escape it. No, nobody can escape criticism. Let me tell you one small story in this context. There was a grandfather and a grandson, and they were traveling from one village to another in the desert of Rajasthan. Now, they had a camel with them. Both of them sat down on the camel and started walking from their village to the next village. It was hot, you know, month of May, very hot. And obviously in Rajasthan desert, the heat is very high. So when they walked, when they went on the, they rode on the camel for a few kilometers, a group of people met them on the way. And they told them, look, how cruel these guys are, you know. The both of them are riding this poor camel who is suffering in this heat. They have no pity on this camel. So the grandfather thought, yeah, they are right, you know, because the camel also needs to be given some relief in this heat. So he got down and the grandson continued to ride the camel. Then they went another few kilometers and they found another group of people. These group of people said that, look at this young guy. He has a lot of energy. He can walk easily. He is making his old grandfather walk in the sun. He has no pity on him. What kind of human being is he? So the young boy thought, yes, they are right. So I should get down. So he got down and he asked his grandfather to ride the camel. When they walked another, when they rode another few kilometers, another group of people met them. And the group of people commented, look at this old man. He's anyway going to die, but he wants to enjoy the camel ride and he's making his young son to suffer in this heat. So what kind of, you know, wisdom he has? He has grown so old but has no wisdom at all. So the grandfather thought they are right. So he got down from the camel, started, both of them started walking. They met another group of people after a while. They say, look at these foolish people. They don't know how to use this camel. They are walking in this hot sun and the camel enjoying. So the grandfather and grandson said, what should we do now? We have done all the combinations. Still, we are getting criticism. So they say the only one option is left, that is to carry the camel on our back. So they decided to carry the camel. And you know what was the result? They said that these are really foolish people. They don't know how to use this animal. And then they came to the conclusion that whatever you do, whatever option you adopt in life, there will be criticism. There will be people who will come and tell you are wrong. Even if you donate your entire property to, for example, to an institution for philanthropy or to poor people, even then people will come and accuse you, oh, he must be having some, you know, hidden agenda behind all this. Why is he doing this? Because he has something hidden, or maybe this is all made out of black money, you know. That is why he wants to get rid of it. So there would be all kinds of criticism. So we have to take that for granted, that whatever we do in our relationships, whatever kind of behavior we do, if we are doing it with good faith, if we are not doing it out of hatred or ill will, then we should not worry about the praise or the criticism. We should not expect praise and we should not worry about the criticism. That has to be avoided. Then we will have good relationships. Then we will have relationships which are healthy, which are based on a very frank and very clear dialogue between the people. So this is the fourth point which I would like to mention, that we have to be somewhere immune to criticism and praise. It does not mean that we become indifferent. No, we should not take it into our heart. This is the nature of the people, and we should understand that by very nature of their personality, they will do it, and we should accept it as it comes. Now, next point is which is actually not only for relationship, but it applies to the entire physical world. That is, the all these relationships are variable and shifting. In that sense, not only relationships, the physical world itself is dynamic. We call it dynamic. Like our mind keeps, you know, moving like wind all the time. Similarly, in this physical world, there's no stability. It keeps moving all the time. Relationships also accordingly change. They keep shifting. Sometimes today you have a friend, tomorrow he becomes your enemy. Next time again, he becomes your friend. And fourth time he becomes, you know, indifferent to you. This is quite common. This is a norm of this world, because this physical world is not stable. It is not a world which is like the you know, Brahma or the spirit or the consciousness. The universal consciousness is static. It is unaltering. It is unchanging. That is eternal. But the physical world is all the time shifting and changing. The padarth jisko kehte hain, the matter jisko bolte hain, the matter is dynamic. There's no movement in this universe when the matter is static. Even a metal which is appearing very, you know, solid, also keep changing. It's decaying. You put a very strong iron bar outside, over time it will decay and disappear. Even if you put a very strong gold piece outside, over time it will disappear. So the movement may be slow in certain cases. In some cases, the movement could be fast, but the very existence of the physical world is characterized by dynamism. Dynamic element is a necessary attribute of the physical world. And similarly, that is a necessary attribute of relationships. Because relationships are not based on inner consciousness. They are based on outer body-mind complex. The body-mind complex is the one which interacts in relationships. If we are interacting with our inner consciousness, with our, you know, the stable consciousness, then you take everybody as divine, you consider everybody as part of one single entity. And then you are in a state of aham brahmasmi. There you don't have to worry at all about relationships. Those people who attain that kind of state in life, they are beyond relationships because they are related to everything which exists in this universe. They are part of that existence itself. But in our normal day-to-day behavior, we are interacting people with our body-mind complex. The other persons are also interacting with body-mind complex. And since mind and body both are subject to constant change, therefore these relationships will have to be shifting and changing. So we should not worry about the change which is happening in this relationship. You will feel, oh, yesterday he was very good to me, today he's, you know, ignoring me completely. Yes, it can happen. It will happen. And it is inevitable that it will happen because this is the very nature of this world. The very nature of this world is to change. Without change, the world cannot exist. If you make everything still, you will feel you are frozen in time. There's no world. There's no movement. Without movement, there's no world. So gati jo hai, gati to sansar ki ek anivari avastha hai. This is a necessary condition of existence of the world, physical world. And therefore, we should not worry about the shifting nature of relationships. People will become friendly, they will become enemy, they will become sour, they will become indifferent, they will become, you know, behave in a different fashion differently. With time and with circumstances, desh or kal, somewhere the time and the circumstances will always impact on these relationships. So this is very, very important factor which we must know, that we cannot expect everything to be stable. For example, you sign a peace agreement between India and Pakistan, and then you presume that now we will have, you know, total peace in the future. That is impossible because you are going on a wrong premise. The world is changing. The peace agreement is only one step in this whole process of whole dynamism, which is going on from time eternal, going further down to time eternal. And this thing will continue to change. Like once people ask Karl Marx that if you are able to establish, for example, socialism, where everybody is getting, you know, according to his needs, and everybody is contributing according to his capacity, the society becomes what you call without any, you know, difference between the poor and the rich. The people become practically, you know, there's equality of income, there's equality of status in the world. So then what will happen? He says it will stay, but he is absolutely wrong there. Even if you achieve that equilibrium, even if you achieve total equality, that is not going to stay. The very nature of this world will change that equality. It is impossible. The two sides of a balance, they keep moving here and there slightly. There is no point where they are totally stable. They will keep moving up and down, up and down. And exactly the same way, the things will keep moving in this world. There's no stability in this world, in this physical world. You should not expect that once you have achieved a particular state in your life, it will stay forever. No. The very next day, it will change. So one should accept this reality of change. This is the very nature of physical existence. This is the very nature of this physical world in which we exist. So relationships are variable, relationships are shifting. The circumstances in which we live, they are shifting. So we should accept them as given. So we should not think that, you know, we will be able to reach a permanent truth or permanent balance or permanent state of happiness in this world. No, that is possible only in the state of Anand. You know, Anand doesn't have an opposite of it. Happiness, dukh aur sukh, inke to vilom hai. Dukh ka vilom sukh hai, sukh ka vilom dukh hai. Lekin Anand ka koi vilom nahi hai. क्योंकि उसका कोई विलोम है ही नहीं. दैट इज ए स्टेट विच इज वेरी डिफरेंट, इन विच यू आर कंप्लीटली स्टैटिक एंड स्टेबलाइज्ड फॉर गुड. यू डू नॉट शिफ्ट फ्रॉम वन टू अनदर. सो दैट इज व्हाई वंस यू आर एस्टैब्लिश्ड इन द ऑलमाइटी, देन यू रीच दैट स्टेट ऑफ आनंद इन विच यू आर स्टेबल. बट दैट स्टेट इज नॉट एग्जिस्टिंग इन द फिजिकल वर्ल्ड. इन द फिजिकल वर्ल्ड वेयर वी लिव, we live in a world which is shifting, which is dynamic, which is changing, and therefore we have to accept that reality and we have to move according to that. Relationships will keep changing in time and in space depending on the circumstances. Now next point which I would like to mention is, I think this we touched upon very briefly earlier, that we need not to do things either to impress others or out of fear from somebody else or as a quid pro quo, that you do this to me, I do this to you. Now in the business world, we do all this. In the business world, there's all the time quid pro quo. Okay, you do this to me, I do to you. This is actually, that is what is called business, because business is exchange in the sense that you do something for me and I do something for you. There's a quid pro quo is implied in business. But if you want a relationship which is based on what you call good faith and stable behavior, which is based on purity, which is based on, you know, what you call divine thoughts, then you should get out of that process of quid pro quo, of fear, or to impress others. We are not in the business of impressing in this world. The impressions keep also shifting. Today you are able to impress people, tomorrow they find that you are totally different and they start laughing at you. I have seen this in practical life in different ways. I have seen people, and you see it today also in our own country. When a politician is in the place of power, people go to him, they praise him, they write great articles about him, they utter fantastic words for him, and they make a beeline to meet him, to take a photograph with him. This is all happens in the real life. When the same politician goes out of power, then what happens? Nobody talks to him. Nobody ever meets him. There's no question of photograph and beeline. All this changes overnight. So, you know, the things which you do to impress others are also unstable. They are not going to stay forever. They can change. And particularly they change actually even faster than the normal things in the normal course. Because the things which are done to impress others, they are very transient and they are very artificial in their by their very nature. And transient artificial things cannot last very long. And that is exposed very quickly. So I think we should not try to impress anybody. We don't have to do that. We behave in our normal self. whatever impression people get, it's up to them. It is depending on their attributes. You don't give an impression. The impression is taken by them depending on their own attributes. You appear and, for example, you come and meet me. Now you are not giving any impression to me if your behavior is just normal, whatever you behave, you do. It is me who is getting the impression based on my bias, my partiality, and my, you know, sanskar or what you call software in my body. So it is all dependent on the combination of the three attributes of nature, which I have inherited, and the experience which I have taken in life since my birth, that will decide my impression of the person I'm meeting. A person who has been deceived many times in life, he always takes others with, you know, a pinch of salt. He suspects others that maybe he will try to deceive you. So that is because of his experience in life. Some people have the tendency to trust others, and they trust others, and once a while they are deceived. So, you know, it depends on the person receiving you, what impression he will get. Like you put, you know, this wax in some place, the wax forms its shape according to the place where it is put. It is not the wax which forms its own shape. The shape is dependent on the shape of the place where you are putting it. Similarly, the impression which others give is not what they give. It is based on what you receive. What is the imprint on your side? Based on that, the impression is carried. So we don't have to impress others. The impression will be carried by them according to their own nature, according to their own attributes, according to their own sanskar, according to their own thinking, biases and unbiased experiences of life. So I think this is very important. We don't have to give an impression of anything. We should be normal in our behavior. We should work with good faith, and we should work with positive language, with positive gestures, with love and affection towards others. That is one way. What others think about it, it's up to them. I know many times people take it as a weakness. I have experienced this myself. When you are kind to others, when you are helping others, they feel that maybe this guy, you know, is weak. He doesn't have enough, what you call, firmness in his, or he's not bold enough. That is what people comment. But don't worry about what others say, what others don't say, whether they praise you or they criticize you. That is not very important. What is important is consistency within you. They should not be, you know, your thinking and your behavior should be together. They should be united. If there's a disunity between your thinking and your behavior, that is the greatest cause of problem. Then you become disturbed. Then your peace is disturbed. Then you are under stress. So try to keep that unity, and relationship will fall in place automatically. If you keep your thinking and action in the same direction, the relationship will not be, you know, creating stress on you. So that is very, very important. So we should not have fear, because fear is again arising because you want to give a positive impression. If you don't want to give any impression, there's no need to fear anything, you see. Fear is the outcome of giving an impression. And if you want to give an impression, naturally you will have fear. So I think we should avoid that situation. No fear, no impression to be given, no praise or no criticism should bother us. And we should behave in a normal, stable way where our thought and our action is united. They are not disunited, they are together. The relationship will be fantastic. This is based on not only my personal behavior, but also on the experiences people have narrated to me in different ways of life. Anything which you try to create false impression will fall very quickly. It will not last very long. The truth has the strong legs to stand on, but falsity doesn't have strong legs to stand on. The falsity will fall very, very fast. So these are some of the important points which I thought I will mention today to conclude this, our talk on harmonious relationships. And just to summarize a few points once again, I would like to say that man is a social animal. Relationships are inevitable in our life. Actually, life is a relationship in a way. Life, the most important segment of our life is based on relationships, whether it is with our parents or with our children or with our family members or with our office employees or with our, society at large, with our neighbors, whatever. So that is an inevitable part where we live in. And these are the sources of our stress. They can disturb our peace. They can disturb our tranquility. And therefore, we have to manage them properly. To manage them properly, we have to follow these 6-7 principles, which we just summarized. One is that the sound waves which we create through our words should be positive. It should create positive energy. It should lead to harmony between the two sides. And the non-action or non-verbal communication should also be in the same way, convey positive thinking, positive and harmonious, energy should be created between the two. And then, of course, the second is we should have always good intentions. We should act with good faith, and there would be no problem at all. If you, in short run, you may be misunderstood, but in longer term, I can assure you, people will understand you properly. The falsity will disappear and the truth will ultimately prevail. Satyamev jayate, that is why we say that. And then we don't have to worry about criticism and praise, because these are normal human tendencies in the world we live in. These will continue to come and go. We don't have to worry about them. The relationships are dynamic. They will be keep shifting. They will be changing, because that is the very nature of this world. And we should not be destabilized by that shifting nature of relationships. We should accept that as given, because that is the nature of the matter. Matter has been, created in a way that it's keep depreciating, keep changing, keep transforming, changing its shapes all the time. So we should continue in that line on these basic guidelines, and we should accept the world as it is. We cannot change people. We have to accept the differences. With people whom we are having relationship, we have to take them as they are. Any attempt to transform them or to change them will only be counterproductive. And therefore, we accept them as they are and we move forward. So if we follow these principles in our relationships, I can assure you that you will not have problems, and at least your peace will not be disturbed. People may misunderstand you, it's possible, because that is the nature of this world. But sooner or later, they will come around and they will feel that this man is genuine and he's, working in good faith. So these things will sort themselves out. You don't have to sort them out. It is the samasti which will sort them out. This is not under your domain. It is under the domain of the, Almighty, who manages this rasti, who manages this, the whole large universe, which is so diverse and so dynamic. So I think with these words, I would like to conclude this talk on harmonious relationships. If you have any questions, I'll be very happy to answer them. Thank you so much.